A2PC section 4.8, applications and models for trigonometric functions. And I have to apologize. I'm not sure if you come here for the puns or not, but I actually don't have one for this. So if you think of something, let me know. But I did not have one ready for this one. All right. So all we've got here are a series of word problems that have us use all the different facets of trigonometry and trigonometric functions that we've covered this chapter. And so we're just going to kind of compile those ideas together and use some calculator work and wizardry to help us answer these questions. All right, so number 20 is our first example. An electrician is running wire from an electric box on a house to a utility pole that's 75 feet away. The angle of elevation to the connection on the pole is 16 degrees. How much wire does the electrician need? So here we've got this utility pole, and then 75 feet away along the ground, here's that electric box at the base of some house, right? If you've seen these types of connections, this is where, usually along the ground, the wire feeds into the house. All right, so running a wire straight from the electric box to that utility pole at 75 feet away, the angle of elevation to where it connects on the pole is 16 degrees. How much wire, when the wire is traveling along that hypotenuse, does the electrician need? So you can kind of see how this sets up a right triangle. That's going to be a key feature of these problems, setting up a triangle and labeling the side lengths that we know or are trying to find, as well as any angle measures that we know. All right, so how much wire? That's x. Well, if we take a look at this, we have a known angle of 16 degrees. So I can look from that angle and say, hey, this 75 is adjacent to that known acute angle. And then the x is the hypotenuse. That helps me figure out which trig function I'm going to use. What uses an adjacent and a hypotenuse? That's the that's the cosine function. So the cosine of our known 16 degrees is going to equal that adjacent 75 over the hypotenuse x. And now this happens quite a bit with trig functions, but you'll notice the x we're solving for is in the denominator. And so we can actually jump right to x equals 75 divided by cosine of 16. We've talked about this algebra in class, why this can be done. But essentially what we would do is we would multiply both sides by x. So then we have x times the cosine of 16, which is just some decimal we can get out of the calculator. And then to solve for x, we would divide away the cosine 16. So algebraically, what happens is the x and the cosine 16 just essentially switch spots. So you are totally able to fast track it this way if you encounter this situation. It does happen quite a bit in these word problems. All right, so in the calculator, I'm just going to make sure I'm in degree mode for this one. We may have to switch back and forth this section depending on what we're given. Most of these are in degrees, though. So if I type in 75 divided by cosine of 16, I get 78.022. Okay, now let's remember, what kind of units do I get on this answer? Or should I put degrees or what? What does this 78 represent? It's a distance measurement. We are measuring our distances in feet. So 78.022 feet of wire for that electrician. And you've probably done work similar to this in your honors geometry in years past. Next, 28, a passenger in an airplane flying at an altitude of 10 kilometers. Okay, so here's our airplane. Altitude is straight up and down, 10 kilometers. Sees two towns due east of the plane. So imagine that we're kind of, the plane is flying towards us, like that. And then passenger is looking out this window. Let's say this is east. But looking down to these two towns along the ground. So here's town one, here's town two. The angles of depression to the two towns are 28 degrees. And the other one in here, the bigger angle, 55 degrees. We're trying to figure out how far apart are these two towns. So we've essentially got two right triangles to work with here. So Let's see, what do we know from our angles? It looks like we always have this adjacent leg. And then this unknown distance down here, which contains our x in it, this is going to be, this is going to be the opposite. All right, so I'm going to try and use my colors here to specify this. We've got a little bit of actual angle work to do. So we do know that if this is 55, if I'm just focusing on this triangle right here, like that, here, the angle that's inside, notice that wasn't measured from horizontal. It was 55 degrees up until this hypotenuse. So that means this is the remaining 35 degrees inside. I hope that's legible. So if I draw that separately, this triangle has some unknown distance along the bottom here. Its angle inside is 35, and we know this is 10 kilometers. So just in that pink triangle, I can find this x, and I'll call it x sub 0, just so it's different from the green x we're actually solving for. But I notice that that's an opposite and an adjacent. So the tangent of that 35-degree angle is going to equal that x value over 10. To solve for x here, I don't need to do any swapping or anything like that. To solve for x, just multiply the 10 onto both sides. So 10 times the tangent of 35 is just going to go right in the calculator, and I get 7.00. So that's nice. I know this distance is 7. Now, when we step back and look at the bigger triangle, I hope this is showing up well enough. Because I have that known 7, if I draw this triangle separately, inside we have to do some of that complementary work again, because my angle 28 is outside the blue triangle. Its complement is going to be what's inside. So 90 minus 28, it's going to be 62 degrees. I still have that same 10 kilometer altitude, and now this base is the 7 that I already found plus the x I'm solving for. Right, so again, from our 62-degree angle, we have an opposite and an adjacent, so we're going to be using the tangent ratio with that known 62 degrees inside, and now its opposite is 7 plus x over the adjacent 10. So 10 times the tangent of 62 degrees is going to equal 7 plus x. I'm going to find 10 times the tangent of 62 in the calculator, and then subtract 7 to finish solving for x. So 10 tangent 62, close that up, minus 7, gives me 11.807. And remember, that x we were looking for, that's the distance between the two towns. We're measuring our distances in this problem in kilometers. So even for word problems, these are quite a bit faster. All right, problem 28, you can see I put a big red X in it. This was a misprint in your note packet. This was the 28 out of the previous version of the textbook. Find the angle of depression from the top of a lighthouse 250 feet above water level to the waterline of a ship that's 2.5 miles offshore. You can feel free to skip over this if you want, but I will go ahead and do it just for the sake of the video here. One thing that is notable about this is that we go from 250 feet for a lighthouse to 2.5 miles. So 1 mile is 5,280 feet. So we do have to do some conversion there to make sure that we're working in the same units as we set up our triangles. But this is kind of a neat problem because it has us find the angle. And so it's worth talking about at the very least. So we have this lighthouse, and if we were looking straight out, we'd be looking horizontally from the top of that lighthouse. And here's our water line. But instead, we're looking downward to where the water meets a ship that's somewhere out at sea. Okay, so this was 250 feet. This is 2.5 miles. I'd like to put this whole thing either all in miles or all in feet. I think it's a lot easier to just multiply 2.5 times 5,280. To find that this is 13,200 feet exactly. That way our units are all lined up. Now, what we're actually solving for in this problem is the angle of depression. And so what makes this interesting is we've got this right triangle formed, but the angle we're looking for is outside. So we've got a couple of different approaches. Some students will say, oh, I'll just solve for the angle that's inside and then subtract that from 90, and that will totally work. Other students will say, oh, well, our line of sight is parallel to the water line, so if we're looking for this angle theta, can't we use alternate interior angles to say that that's also this angle theta in the triangle? And either one totally works. Personally, I see the second one with the alternate interior angles, and I think it saves a step, but you have options here. Geometry affords us a lot of different properties that we can use. So let's say we're solving for this angle theta down here, which is equivalent to our angle of depression. From that theta, we have an opposite and an adjacent. So that's a tangent. So the tangent of our theta is 250 over 13,200. And notice that we're looking for the angle. So theta is the angle whose tangent has that ratio. Since I'm solving for an angle, I'm going to use the inverse. So we'll do second tangent to bring up tangent inverse. And in goes the 250 divided by 13,200. And I'm expecting a small angle here, right? We're looking way out, 2.5 miles into the ocean. Yeah, sure enough, we get 1.085 degrees. And again, that's just the angle we would tilt our head downward, barely even registering that movement to see that ship out at sea. But again, this is one that it doesn't match up with your textbook. It was from a previous version of the book that I debated keeping in the lesson or not. So that's why I put the big red X over it. All right, next, bearings. Bearings are just degree measurements based off of a compass rose. So if you think about north pointing straight up on a compass, north and south and east and west, how we would read a bearing, like let's say we're trying to head in this direction and we wanted like 35 degrees here. So how we measure the bearing is we say we're heading to the north 35 degrees from the east. So we're turning toward the north from the east, 35 degrees goes in the middle. All right, so let's see if we can't sketch up the situation here for 44. So a plane leaves an airport and it's 160 miles north and 85 miles east from the airport. Here's the airport. And we want to know from there, if the pilot looks at his compass, what should his bearing be to send him right back to the airport? Okay, so we have to go from east or west toward the north or south. So it looks like my bearing is going to be this angle going from the west towards the south, right? If we think about north, east, south, and west, never eat soggy waffles. So I know that I'm going to be turning toward the south some number of degrees from the west. All right, and so to find that angle theta inside, it's the angle whose tangent, we've got an opposite and an adjacent, if we kind of complete that triangle there. Theta is the angle whose tangent is making a 160 over 85 ratio. So second tangent, yet again, you'll find that tangent's one of the more common ones when you're doing an inverse, just because usually the hypotenuse is more difficult to measure in a real world situation. I get 62.02 degrees. So towards the south, 62.02 degrees from the west. Two fire towers are 30 kilometers apart, and Tower A is due west of Tower B. Okay, so they mentioned north, south, east, and west. I'm just going to throw this off to the side just so I don't mix up my directions here. So Tower A is due west of Tower B, and we know that they're 30 kilometers apart. A fire is spotted from both towers, and the bearings from A and B are from the east 14 degrees to the north and from the west 34 degrees to the north. Find the distance of the fire from that segment AB. Okay, so there's some fire happening up here, and we know that my bearing from fire tower A is towards the north from the east. Okay, so from A, here's east, here's north. If I'm looking at that fire, that's making a 14 degree angle. And then from fire tower B, here's the north, here's the west. From the west, 34 degrees towards the north. So this is not to scale at all. 34 degrees. And what we're trying to find is how far perpendicular to AB, how far is that fire? All right, well, this is pretty interesting. Since we have two towers and kind of two right triangles that are sharing that X, I'm guessing this is going to be some type of systems problem. But let's take a look. If the total distance from A to B is 30, let's call this one Y and this other one 30 minus Y. That way, we've got two triangles that only have labels that are X and Y for our unknowns. Now, regarding tower A, I know that the tangent of A, that angle at A, tangent of 14 degrees, is equal to X over Y. And from tower B, I know its tangent, its opposite over adjacent, from that 34 degree angle we have over there by tower B, is going to be X over 30 minus Y. Now, because this is a substitution type problem, I want to be aware of what I'm solving for. So I want to keep X in the problem, meaning I want to solve both of these for Y. For the first one, if I solve for Y, here's that little swap it out technique, since the Y I'm looking for is in the bottom. And for tangent 34, this one, sorry, there should be an equal sign there. Here we can do the same, swap it out. 30 minus Y equals X over tangent 34. But to solve for Y, I would want to add Y over to the other side of the equal sign and subtract the X over tangent 34. So 30 minus X over tangent 34 is equal to my Y. Okay, and now that I have these two equivalent, we've got a healthy amount of algebra to do. I'm able to set those two things that Y is equivalent to, I'm able to set them equal to each other since they both equal Y. So X over tangent 14 is equal to 30 minus X over tangent 34. Let's group our X terms together. Let's factor out an X. And then we'll divide away. Remember, this is all some big decimal we can get in the calculator. So that distance X, what we were looking for all along, is equal to 30 over the quantity 1 over tangent 14 degrees plus 1 over the tangent of 34 degrees. And so into the calculator this goes, just very carefully grouped, right? So in the calculator, I'm typing in 30 divided by big grouping 1 divided by tangent 14, and I'm making sure to close that tangent, plus 1 divided by tangent 34, close that tangent and close up the whole denominator. And what do I get when I type all of that in? 30 divided by group 1 over tangent 14, close that, plus 1 over tangent 34, close that, close denominator. I get 5.461. kilometers. So very, very cool to see the algebra that we're covering in this course. sort of mesh and commingle with the geometry and right triangle trig that we learned in honors geometry last year. And our final example, oh man, I love this. Determine the angle between the diagonal of a cube and an adjacent edge. Okay, I'm going to try my best to make a cube. Okay, so at the diagonal of the cube is going to go from one corner through all of the interior to the other, and then adjacent to that, one of the edges of the cube. So it could be here, it could be here, it could be here. There are a lot of different adjacent edges we could choose. I'm going to choose this one because it's most visible. So let's think about how we want to do this. So it looks like if I'm trying to find this angle here, that's my theta. It's important to realize it does not matter what the edges of the cube are as long as they're all congruent. That's what defines a cube. So let's just say that all of these are ones, make it a unit cube. All those edges of are of length one. And it'd be nice to have some side lengths on a triangle because then I could use the angle whose, right? I could use some inverse trig to do that. So I'm actually going to connect right here the end point of that edge that I marked out with that other end point of the diagonal that I had initially marked out. Okay, so now what we've got is if I'm just looking at this face of the cube right here, you see how we've set up a 45, 45, 90, a 1, and a 1. So this green diagonal that I drew in on this face is actually a square root of 2. It's a 45, 45, 90. And now if I extrapolate that and just kind of lay that slice of the cube out, it kind of looks like this. We have a root 2, and then we have our edge of the cube, which is 1. Here is our theta, and we're looking for that theta. Sorry, I can go ahead and erase that. We don't even need to know that distance of the diagonal. And so to find that angle theta, we'll go ahead and stick to red here. Notice it's the angle whose tangent is root 2 over 1. Theta equals, we've got a root 2 for an opposite, and a 1 for an adjacent, so we're going to use the angle whose tangent is root 2 over 1, or just root 2. So second tangent, inverse tangent, I'm going to input a square root of 2. And I get 54.736 degrees. Again, very cool to tie geometry in with the algebra. Not that you need to hear my history or anything like that, but when I was in high school, we had a class that was called analytic geometry, and it was like entirely devoted to problems like this and some other relationships we'll encounter later in this course. It's kind of meshed its way in with the Algebra 2 work that we'll see here. But again, really fascinating problems. It's fun to add a visual element to the algebra that we're doing. Okay, that concludes. You can see the very short homework assignment. We've only got 6 problems here. It does not take much to kind of see how this trigonometry works its way into the real world. But that concludes our chapter 4. I hope you've enjoyed it, and thank you for watching.